Long ago, you spoke in a vision to your faithful people. You said, I have raised up a warrior. I have selected him from the common people to be the king. I have found my servant David. I have anointed him with my holy oil. He will call out to me, you are my father, my God, and the rock of my salvation. I will make him my firstborn son, the mightiest king on earth. I will preserve an heir for him. His throne will be as endless as the days of heaven. But now you have rejected him and cast him off. You are angry with your anointed king. You have renounced your covenant with him. You have thrown his crown in the dust. You have strengthened his enemies and made them all rejoice. You have made his sword useless and refused to help him in battle. You have ended his splendor and overturned his throne. Oh Lord, how long will this go on? Will you hide yourself forever? How long will your anger burn like fire?
Of all eternity, the passion of
place, while she was still a virgin, she became pregnant through the power of the Holy Spirit. Joseph, her fiancé, was a good man and did not want to disgrace her publicly, so he decided to break the engagement quietly.
What should I do? Is there a future here? How can we marry? Oh, Mary, there is no place for me. The child is not mine.
What happens now? This baby's on his way. Will he be welcomed by Joseph?
Thank you.
will live among you. He is a mighty Savior. He will take delight in you with gladness. With his love, he will calm all your fears. He will rejoice over you with joyful songs. Joseph did what the angel of the Lord commanded him, and took Mary as his wife. But he had no union with her until she gave birth to a son in Bethlehem of Judea, and he gave him the name Jesus.
Thank you.
Jesus was born in Bethlehem, in Judea, during the reign of King Herod. About that time, some wise men from eastern lands arrived in Jerusalem, asking, "Where is the newborn King of the Jews? We saw his star as it rose, and we have come to worship him." King Herod was deeply disturbed when he heard this, as was everyone.
Star nation, and
Judah, my son, is a young lion. The scepter will not depart from Judah, nor the ruler's staff from his descendants, until the coming of the one to whom it belongs, the one whom all nations will honor. After speaking with Herod, the wise men went their way, and the star they had seen in the east guided them to Bethlehem. It went ahead of them and stopped over the place where the child was. The place where the child was. Many of us have come to a place like this. A place where we were changed. Changed by God's grace for God's glory. For some, this may have been a youth summer camp with a counselor, or at the foot of their bed with mom and dad, or on their knees in their living room, or holding someone's hand in a hospital room, praying for God's mercy and love. Many of us have come to the place where we were changed, the foot of the cross. The wise men came to bow down to a young boy. Wise men seek him still. God came to a place, or excuse me, David came to a place where he sought the Lord with all his heart. Let's listen in on David's prayer. Bend down, O Lord, and hear my prayer. Answer me, for I need your help. Protect me, for I am devoted to you. Save me, for I serve you and trust you. You are my God. Be merciful to me, O Lord, for I am calling on you constantly. Give me happiness, O Lord, for I give myself to you. O Lord, you are so good, so ready to forgive, so full of unfailing love for all who ask for your help. Listen closely to my prayer, O Lord. Hear my urgent cry. I will call to you whenever I am in trouble, and you will answer me. With all my heart I will praise you, O Lord my God. I will give glory to your name forever, for you love me, and your love for me is very great. You have rescued me from the depths of death. O God, insolent people rise up against me. A violent gang is trying to kill me. You mean nothing to them, but you, O Lord, are a God of compassion and mercy, slow to anger and filled with unfailing love and faithfulness. Look down and have mercy on me. Give your strength to your servant. Save me, the son of your servant. Send me a sign of your favor. Thank you. When they saw the star, they were filled with joy. They entered the house and saw the child with his mother Mary. They bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasure chests and gave him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh.
Thank you.
sent soldiers to kill all the boys in and around Bethlehem who were 2 years old and under, based on the wise men's report of the star's first appearance.
Must they fall soon?
darkness and despair will not go on forever. The land of Zebulun and Naphtali will be humbled, but there will be a time in the future when Galilee of the Gentiles, which lies along the road that runs between the Jordan and the sea, will be filled with glory. The people who walk in darkness will see a great light. And for those who lived in the land where death casts its shadow, a light has shined. Because those who were trying to kill the child are dead. So Joseph got up and returned to the land of Israel with Jesus and his mother. But when he learned that the new ruler of Judah was Herod's son, Archelaus, he was afraid to go there. Then, after being warned in a dream, he left for the region of Galilee. So the family went and lived in a town called Nazareth. This fulfills what the prophet had said, "He will be called
Far and wide are the
dawns, and the Messiah, the morning star, shines in your heart. You must worship the Messiah as Lord of your life, and if someone asks you about your hope as a believer, always be ready to explain it. For you are a chosen people, you are royal priests, a holy nation, God's very own possession. As a result, you can show others the goodness of God.
Here last Sunday, you got to hear me preach all the way through Matthew 1 and 2. This musical is based on everything in Matthew 1 and 2. So I'm not going to preach that sermon. I did that last week. But I'm going to talk a little bit about giving people an opportunity to come to the Savior, because that's what this is about. We have just sung the gospel message. The good news about Jesus Christ has been presented in song. And there's this poem written by Bonaventure in the 13th century. I thought it was pretty cool. It's about the wise men, and this is what he said. When the Lord was born in Bethlehem of Judah, a star appeared to the Magi in the east with its brightness, showed them the way to the home of the humble king. Do not now turn away from the brilliance of that star in the east which guides you. Become a companion of the holy kings. Accept the testimony of the Jewish scriptures about Christ and avert the evil of the treacherous king. With gold, frankincense, and myrrh, venerate Christ the King as true God and man. Together with the first fruits of the Gentiles, to be called to faith, adore, confess, and praise this humble God lying in a manger. And thus, warned in a dream not to follow Herod's pride, you will return to your country in the footsteps of the humble Christ. This story presents very clearly the choices that we have in regards to the salvation that God planned for us. As you can tell, God's plan of our salvation started a long time ago, right? A long time ago, he planned to send his son to save us. Jesus came as the fulfillment of prophecies given hundreds of years before he came, that God would send the one, the Messiah, the anointed one, the king, the savior for us. And that was Jesus. And we can see in this story that we can have different responses to this. We could be like the professional religious people, the scribes, the Pharisees, the pastors. When they were asked a question about the Messiah, they said, oh yeah, he's supposed to be born in Bethlehem. No interest at all, really. They were bored by salvation, bored by God's plan. The possibility that the Messiah was only 11 miles away did not excite them. They did not go. They just gave an answer. So our response this Christmas to Jesus coming can be just like theirs. Oh yeah, I know all about that. I know everything about God's salvation. I've heard the story before. I know, gospel, good news. God sends his son Jesus, dies for me. Got that. But they completely missed meeting the Son of God. They didn't see him. Or we could respond like Herod. Quite a contrast, right? Herod, who was only interested in who being king. Himself. The news that maybe God sent somebody that he would have to submit to, not good news for him. He doesn't want to submit to anyone. Even if God sent him, he doesn't want to submit to him. He wants to run his own life. And he will take steps to make sure that he's in control of his own life. That's Herod's response to the arrival of Jesus. So there's boredom. Yeah, I know about salvation. There's adamancy. I'm in charge of my life. Or there's the wise men who weren't even Jewish and used astrology, which is forbidden in the Bible, by the way. And somehow, they were seeking the Savior, and they ended up in Bethlehem, right at the foot of this little baby. And their response was to fall on their knees and to recognize the salvation that God had brought. And their response was an open heart to what God was doing. They're the ones who did not miss out, because they had the attitude of receiving what God was doing for salvation. And this morning, that choice is clear. This story that you've heard sung is true. This is a true story. It happened in a real place that you can visit today. Real person, Jesus, who lived and walked on this earth. This is a true story, and our response can be one of boredom and dismissal, or adamancy about running my own life, or we can fall on our knees like the Christmas hymn says, and submit and worship and accept the salvation that God has brought in our lives. I want to make sure that you don't leave today without having that opportunity. So we're just going to pray, and I'm going to give you that chance. Why don't you go ahead and bow your head. If today is the day that you're ready to really experience Christmas by receiving the Son of God into your life, I just ask you to quietly in your heart pray with me. Father, thank you for loving me. Thank you for planning to save me. I thank you for sending your son, Jesus. I thank you that he grew up and was willing to die on a cross for me. I thank you that his blood shed on the cross forgives my sin. I thank you that on the third day he rose from the dead, and that you give the promise of eternal life, that I can live with you forever, and that you are with me. I thank you for the promise of Jesus that he would be with us to to the end of the age. Father, I thank you for the salvation sent in your Son, and I place my faith in him. Thank you for making me a part of your family through the work he did. In Jesus' name, amen. Now this morning, if you prayed that prayer, became a believer in Jesus, please don't leave here without just letting me know. Just come up and say that you prayed that prayer, and I'll say that was awesome. And I'm really happy. And I want you to do that so that you tell one person about this new life you have before you leave here. It's very important. Well, let's go ahead and stand together. We're going to sing the one verse of O Come All You Faithful, which speaks about what I'm talking about. Coming to Christ with the attitude of submission and worship, which I hope for some of you, this is the first Christmas where Jesus is actually going to be the Lord, and you can sing this song with all of your heart. Let's sing together.
Oh, come all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant, oh, come ye to Bethlehem. Come and behold him, born the King of ages.
Christmas Eve service at 7. You're welcome to come. And then next week, we're going to start reading through the entire Bible out loud in the sanctuary here. It takes 3 days. You're welcome to come in and listen or volunteer to read. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.